Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm Jaycee, and today we are raising a glass in honor of a woman who was a poet, a memoirist, a singer, a dancer, a screenwriter, a director, and, fun fact, a one-time award-winning cable car conductor. I am speaking, of course, of Dr. Maya Angelou. Dr. Maya Angelou lived like 1,000 lives in her 86 years on the planet, and we are making a drink in her honor that I am calling a Maya Angelfood. It is sort of a riff on a cocktail that should bring out the flavors that you would see in Angelfood cake. To make this drink, you are going to need some whiskey, some amaretto, some pineapple juice, some lemon juice, and some vanilla. We're going to pair this cocktail with some traditional Southern tea cookies. To make that, you are going to need the standard ingredients that you would find in your pantry, as well as some rose water and some lemon zest. While you go wrangle all of that up, I am going to start the story of Maya Angelou. Now, Maya Angelou wrote 7 autobiographies during her lifetime. This is to say that we are going to only be touching the very top of the iceberg when it comes to all of the stories that can be told about Maya Angelou's life. Maya was born in St. Louis in 1928, but she lived the beginning of her life in California with her mother and father and her older brother, Bailey. When she was 4 years old, her parents' marriage sort of violently dissolved, and her earliest memories are from the train trip that she took with her brother from California to Stamps, Arkansas. They made the journey totally alone, these two tiny children, with their train tickets pinned to their jackets. When they arrived in Stamps, they were met by their paternal grandmother and their Uncle Willie, who they lived with. Now, all of this is covered in Maya's first autobiography, published in 1969, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings was a finalist for the National Book Award and was on the New York Times bestseller list for 2 years. It is also one of the most commonly banned books, in part because of the violent, sexual, graphic nature of sections of the book. When Maya was 8 years old, she left Stamps and she went to live with her mother in St. Louis. There, her mother's boyfriend sexually abused her and ultimately raped her. Maya told her brother this. The man was arrested, he was put on trial, and found guilty. He was in jail for only one day. Upon his release, he was murdered, likely by Maya's uncles. After that, Maya went mute. She stopped speaking, she became completely withdrawn, and her mother sent her back to Stamps to live with her grandmother. Her grandmother would reassure Maya, saying that it was okay that she wasn't talking now because when God and Maya saw fit, she was gonna start talking. And when she did, she was going to be a preacher. She was going to preach the word. And Maya would think, this poor ignorant woman, doesn't she realize I am never going to speak again? My voice killed a man. That's what my voice does. It kills people. During this time, Maya was listening. Maya was taking in everything around her and reading voraciously. She read every book in her school library and every book that she could get her hands on from the white school library. Eventually, Maya was introduced to an older lady in her town named Miss Bertha Flowers. It was Miss Flowers who would invite Maya over for lemonade and tea cakes that finally opened Maya back up. Now, in Miss Flowers' honor, we are going to make our own tea cookies. We're going to start by taking one stick of softened butter, and we're going to cream that together with a cup of sugar. Then we're going to add in a teaspoon of vanilla, a teaspoon of lemon zest, and my special ingredient, a teaspoon of rose water. Again, in honor of Miss Flowers, some flower water, as it were. I have to tell you that I'm a little intimidated making this recipe in honor of Maya, for a couple reasons. First of all, on top of everything else that Maya accomplished during her life, Maya was an extraordinary cook and party hostess. She, in fact, published 2 cookbooks during her lifetime, and her pre-trimming parties and New Year's Day parties were the stuff of legend, almost as legendary as her excellent cuisine. Beyond that, Maya described the tea cookies that Miss Flowers would make in I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. Here is an excerpt. Although Miss Flowers warned that she hadn't tried her baking at sweets for some time, I was certain that like everything else about her, the cookies would be perfect. They were flat, round wafers, slightly browned on the edges and butter yellow in the center. She said she had made them expressly for me and that she had a few in the kitchen that I could take home to my brother. So I jammed one whole cake in my mouth and the rough crumbs scratched the inside of my jaws. If I hadn't had to swallow, it would have been a dream come true. Can these cookies live up to that? I don't know, guys. I'm not sure. But we're going to be bold. We're going to be brave. We're going to try it out. After you cream together the sugar and the butter and you add in your vanilla, your rose water, your lemon zest, you are also going to add in one egg, the last of our wet ingredient. And then we are going to slowly add in our cup and a half of flour before we roll this out into flat discs, wrap it in saran wrap, and pop it in the refrigerator to let it chill for about 30 minutes. That's what's next for us. But what was next for Maya? What happened between her childhood in stamps and her writing one of the greatest memoirs of all time? Well, it's almost easier to ask what didn't happen. So as I mentioned briefly at the top, she was working as a cable car driver in San Francisco when she was only 16 years old. She was actually the first African-American woman to hold that position, which is why she's award-winning. She was given a Lifetime Achievement Award for breaking that color barrier. It was this same year when she was 16 that Maya had sex for the first time. She went with a boy and said, "Really? That's it?" She was incredibly unimpressed and even less impressed when she later found out that she was pregnant. She told her mother, who was incredibly understanding. Her mother said, "Are you in love with the boy?" Maya said no. And her mother said, "Well, there's no reason to ruin three lives." So just after graduating high school, Maya gave birth to her son, Guy Johnson, who she has many times said is the greatest accomplishment of her life. As a young mother, Maya took on a lot of odd jobs to make ends meet. She worked as a paint stripper in a mechanics shop. She worked as a fry cook. She also worked as a sex worker. She uses the word prostitute in her book, Gather Together in My Name. She decided to write openly about this because she felt that growing up, every adult she knew would always say, "Oh man, I've never done anything bad. I don't have any skeletons in my closet. In fact, I don't even have a closet." Maya felt that this was a way of making young people feel shame about their decisions, and she didn't want to be any part of that. Now, in her early 20s, Maya met and married Tosh Angelos, a match that her mother initially disapproved of because Tosh was white. The marriage only lasted 3 years, but the name would last the rest of Maya's life. Maya had become a dancer and performer, and she would go by her birth name, Marguerite Johnson, or sometimes Rita Johnson. In fact, she actually had a brief collaboration with Alvin Ailey as a dance team, and they went by Al and Rita. There was a manager at a club, however, who suggested that Maya use her family nickname, Maya, which came from her brother Bailey, who would call her Maya's sister, and then her married last name, Angelou. In fact, most people pronounce her last name incorrectly. Most people pronounce it Angelou, but she herself pronounces it Angelou, derived from her first husband's last name, Angelos. As a performer, Maya was quite successful. She danced in calypso clubs throughout California, but really got her big break when she was cast in the European tour of Porgy and Bess. She toured Europe for 2 years before returning to New York, where she performed quite a lot off-Broadway, most notably perhaps in a play called The Blacks, where she appeared alongside Cicely Tyson, Louis Gossett, and James Earl Jones, among others. It was during this time that Maya's friends encouraged her to focus more on her writing. She'd been writing poems and plays and song lyrics. She became involved with the Harlem Writers Group, which connected her with many of the most prominent African-American writers of the day. It was also her involvement in the Harlem Writers Guild that truly ignited her activist flame in the late 50s and early 60s. She met with Dr. Martin Luther King and became the Northern organizer for the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. It was through her work as an anti-apartheid activist that Maya came to know South African freedom fighter Vuzumi Makay. They fell in love, and Maya and her son Guy followed him to Cairo, where they lived for a year, and Maya worked as the editor of a newspaper. After the relationship fizzled out, Maya moved to Ghana with her son, which is where he attended college, and she continued to write and work there. This is where she became closely associated with Malcolm X. She, in fact, decided to ultimately return to the States in 1965 in order to help Malcolm build up the Organization of African American Unity. It was only a few weeks after Maya's return that Malcolm X was assassinated. Then 3 years later, on Maya's 40th birthday, Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated as well. Maya was adrift and depressed when her close friend, writer James Baldwin, knocked on her door and said he was taking her out. She was at a dinner party with Jules Pfeiffer, the cartoonist, and his wife, and they were all sharing their, you know, childhood stories, and Maya shared hers and wowed them all. The very next morning, Jules' wife, Judy, called an editor at Random House, and the editor encouraged Maya to write her memoirs, to write an autobiography. Maya was reluctant. That's not totally accurate. Maya said no. And the editor said, okay, it's probably just as well anyway. I mean, it's almost impossible to make an autobiography something actually literary. Maya said, okay, fine, I'll write it. The resulting book was, of course, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. Now, Maya had a very specific writing practice. Maya would go away into a hotel room, bringing nothing with her except four yellow legal pads, she always wrote in longhand, a thesaurus, a deck of cards to play solitaire, a Bible, and oftentimes, some whiskey. So we are mixing up a whiskey cocktail in her honor, a cocktail that I am calling, as I said, a Maya Angelfood. It has the flavors of Angelfood cake, we hope, and it's a little riff, of course, a little pun on her name, Maya Angelou. We are going to start by adding 1.5 ounces of whiskey. I am using a honey whiskey, but any whiskey will be just fine. And then 1.5 ounces of amaretto, as well as 1.5 ounces of pineapple juice, and a dash of both vanilla and lemon juice. We can call that dash 1/4 ounce, but you know, there's flexibility in this. Then we're going to shake it up and pour it over ice. Now, after the success of I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, more and more opportunities open themselves up to Maya. The book wasn't just a beautifully written, captivating, heart-wrenching tale. It was also steeped in this long tradition of African-American biographies, the slave narratives that had been written by Frederick Douglass and Sojourner Truth. Yet it was something completely new and unique, a first-person narrative from an African-American woman, a three-dimensional modern woman with a beautiful fluidity of language. It's thrilling, really. It feels like at any moment the words might turn into poetry or song. You have to read it. It is a beautiful, beautiful book. You know what else you have to do? You have to cut out your cookies. Let's take a sip for... Oh, really good. We're gonna come back to that. Okay, we have our dough. It's been chilling in our refrigerator. We're gonna unwrap it. We're gonna roll it out, and we're going to cut it into some shapes. The end result should be something like this. Now, a traditional tea cookie would be a big round circle, the way Maya described in I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, but you know, we're shaking it up a little bit. I wanted to use my fun feminist symbol cookie cutter in this instance. Once all of your cookies are done, you are going to pop them into the oven and wait 10 or 15 minutes. Now, in 1969, at 41 years old, Maya Angelou was done waiting. Her career was flourishing. She wrote, produced, and narrated a series for NET, which was the precursor to PBS, about African Americans and blues music. She appeared in Look Away on Broadway in 1972 and was nominated for a Tony Award. In 1977, she had a supporting role in the classic TV miniseries Roots. And that's not all. Like, also during the 70s, she was still writing. She knocked out another, like, 3 autobiographies in the 70s. In the 80s, even though she didn't have a college degree, she went on to have a career as a professor. She also became a mentor to many African-American pop culture icons, not the least of which is Oprah, but also, you know, like Dave Chappelle was a mentee of hers, and Tupac Shakur. She has this whole story about sitting Tupac down and telling him that there was no appropriate usage of the N-word, even in rap music, and there were tears, and I mean, she's basically like that wise aunt that all of us desperately need. Her role as auntie for the nation was definitely solidified in 1993 when Bill Clinton selected Maya to read a poem at his inauguration. This is the first time a poem had been read at an inauguration since Robert Frost in 1961. Maya's poem, On the Pulse of Morning, earned her a Grammy Award. She also, in the 90s, made the Billboard charts because she did spoken word with an R&B duo called Ashford and Simpson. Now, no one recites Maya's work the way Maya does, but I still want to share one of my favorite Maya Angelou poems with you while I play our finished cookies. Goes like this. Pretty women wonder where my secret lies. I'm not cute or built to suit a supermodel size. When I start to tell them, they think I'm telling lies. I say it's in the reach of my arms, the stride of my hip, the step of my walk, the curl of my lips. I'm a woman, phenomenal woman. That's me. I love this poem. It seems appropriate for the Feminist Cocktail Hour and for our feminist tea cookies. Of course, to say that Maya Angelou was a phenomenal woman is somehow still an understatement with all that she accomplished during her lifetime. Even though she's gone, she passed away in 2014, her legacy still looms so large. It can be intimidating to look at all that she accomplished in her life and look back at your own life and think about what you have done in your time here. But it can also be, and should also be, inspiring. Inspiring you to do new things, like make some tea cookies. Let's try these cookies out. You can see the shape came out okay. They spread a little, but not as much as they might have. And the color is the way that she describes in Like the Cave Bird Sings. It's buttery yellow in the middle, and it's got these nice brown edges. Let's give it a taste. It's really good. Crispy on the edges, but buttery and doughy in the middle. It's supposed to have a cake-like quality, and it does. You also get the lemon and just a hint of the rose water. If I made them again, I might be a little heavier on the rose water. I might go with 2 teaspoons instead of 1. Let's start with our cocktail. Cocktail's nice. Goes well with the cookies. It brings out some of those floral notes. The lemon ties everything together. It's really a beautiful combination, and I wasn't 100% sure it would be. I experiment a little bit with these things, but I'm never sure until I taste with you. Now, if you're at home mixing along, cooking along, and things didn't turn out, if things kind of fell apart, look, if you're just sitting behind your keyboard getting anxious because, you know, the world is falling apart, I want to encourage you to take a note from our dear wise aunt. No matter what happens, or however bad it seems today, life does go on, and tomorrow will be better. I hope that your today is great, that your tomorrow is better, and I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. If you're enjoying my videos, please like, please share, please subscribe, and please come back next week. I'm gonna have a new lady, a new libation, and until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls. Come on.